Okay, why don't we get started? Hi everyone, thanks for coming. My name is Jeff Williams. I'm the CTO and founder of a company called Contrast Security. And I was for 8 years the chair of OWASP until I wised up. But I love OWASP and it's great to be here. Today I'm going to be giving a talk about continuous application security. You've heard of continuous delivery, continuous integration, continuous deployment. I'm going to try and interpret that for application security and show you how it can work and can be better than what we're doing today. So we'll start out. This is not a basketball. This is a basketball coach. And this is the Wilson 9450 because the basketball court is 94 feet by 50 feet. So this basketball has a ton of sensors inside it. The sensors, as you play your normal game, the sensors measure the arc of your shot release speed, your dribble speed. It tells you which hand is dribbling stronger. It's even the rotation on your shot gives you all those numbers. So it's actually really amazing. It connects to your phone via Bluetooth, and it gives you this continuous monitoring of your basketball game. I started using this a couple weeks ago, and it's fantastic. So here's my dashboard for my game, and you can see I'm shooting too flat. Like, the 9450 has a model of what good basketball looks like, and your shot should be somewhere between 42 and 48% degrees, and I got a couple in that range, but most of my shots are coming too flat. Now, I've been playing basketball for 30 years, and I didn't know this, because nobody tells you, because they don't care, and it's actually kind of hard to see what somebody's arc actually is. So I think this is fantastic. So this thing has a model in it of good basketball, and it continuously compares your game against the model to give you great feedback on what you're doing. And I think there's a huge lesson here for application security, which we'll talk about today. So really, this is a basketball coach, right? This is the new approach. Sensors plus model gives you continuous feedback on whatever you're trying to do well. And in a lot of ways, it's better than a human coach because they're always there. Now, do you still need a coach? Sure, probably. But now your coach doesn't have to sit there and watch you while you shoot 1,000 free throws or run sprints all day. You can do that with sensors. You can monitor that. And your coach can focus on giving you strategic advice for how to play the game better. So there's no more guessing. I like to call this approach Moneyball. If you saw that movie, you know it's numerics, metrics-based approach to application security, and I think we can play Moneyball with AppSec. So I've given a couple talks on this that I encourage you to go look at. One was at AppSecUSA a year ago called Application Security at DevOps Speed and Portfolio Scale, and in that talk I focused on what makes a great sensor. Like, what sensors can we actually add to application security during the development process? What can we measure? What can we do? What can we do easily, actually? And then later that year, I gave a talk called Building an Application Security Network, Application Security Sensor Network. And this is about building out an infrastructure to sort of manage those sensors, gather that data together, pull it together, and do some analytics and create those dashboards. So I encourage you to check those out because there's a lot of background there that I can't get into here. But this talk, we're going to take it all the way to a full program built around the ideas of continuous application security. Let's take a second first to just rewind, make sure everybody understands why application security is so important and why it needs to change. Traditional application security programs are built around experts and expert tools. And they're all out there in the hallway. You got tools that, you know, static analysis tools and dynamic analysis tools that basically require experts to set up and run. And that's a fundamental bottleneck on getting application security done. If you've got a big application portfolio, your team can't handle the bandwidth. So I've seen a lot of these programs over the last, I've been doing this for about 15 years, and I've seen and worked with a lot of these programs. They can't scale across the whole portfolio. Most organizations get to about 10% of their portfolio, sort of the critical ones, and then they have to stop. They can't handle the bandwidth. And that's unfortunate. The other thing that's sort of a real tragedy is that we're not really producing any good assurance.
I mean, we spend a lot of time doing code reviews and pen tests and running scans and tools, but all we end up with is a big pile of vulnerabilities, right? That doesn't really tell you that anything is good. It's not an assurance argument. It doesn't give anybody any confidence about the software. These programs also don't get good coverage. We talked about coverage over the portfolio. They also don't get very good vulnerability coverage, particularly if you're relying on automated tools like static and dynamic. You're going to miss a lot of the important stuff, particularly authentication, access control, and encryption. Tools can't analyze those, and that's where most of the critical vulnerabilities are. So we're really not getting great coverage there. And the worst thing, I think, is that application security programs are pissing everybody off. They're not a good process fit for software development. They're insulting to developers. They inspire fear in executives, and frankly, they're kind of boring for security professionals. I think we can do a lot better matching up to the process of modern software development. So, not surprisingly, these programs aren't working, and we're seeing the results in breaches. So, Verizon DBIR report, which you should read if you're in this field, came out. It shows 36% of breaches are due to flaws in applications. 36% of them. That is by far the biggest category of breaches are due to application vulnerabilities. All these things we hear about in the news, APT, POS attacks, DDoS attacks, insiders, card skimmers, all that, only a tiny percentage of what comes from application security. But what's tragic is that when you look at the spending in the industry, only 1.7% of security budgets get spent on AppSec. You know why that is? Because we suck. We are not explaining the problem well enough. Even in the face of incredibly damning statistics, we're not able to command the budget for some reason. And frankly, I think it's really hard for organizations to spend money on AppSec because it's so difficult to do. So we've got a real problem in application security. We need to figure out a way to do it differently. So I think waterfall thinking sort of pervades application security. Every activity you hear about is tied to a phase in the life cycle, right? It happens at design time or at integration time or coding or goes into production. I think we need to get out of that mindset. I think we need to think more about a software factory. Like, this is a development organization that takes business needs and it turns it into running high quality code, right? And it's continuously working. And so what our job is, we need to figure out how to get that factory to produce secure code without messing it up, right? We can't just break it. So the sort of the naive approach to doing application security is to put a bunch of gates and checkpoints into this process and try to get the factory to produce something different. But it's kind of ham-handed and it doesn't end up really being effective. Now, it's important to understand that these software factories come in all different shapes and sizes. Small shops, big shops, some are agile, some are DevOps, some are process-oriented, some are technology-oriented. There's a massive range, and any of those shops can produce secure code. So I don't think that the right approach going forward is to sort of compare these software shops against each other to see what everyone's doing. I think what's important is that we measure the output, that we actually come up with a way to measure whether they're actually producing secure code. And it gets back to the 9450 here. We have to have a model of what security looks like so that we can measure against that. And once we get over that hurdle, then we can establish, we can put sensors in place, and I'll talk about how it works going forward. So a great quote from Zane Lackey at Etsy. He said, "Development organizations view delays as damage and route around them." So you can instantly see the way that we currently practice application security is going to be a problem because we're establishing delays. We're putting delays into the process and we're fundamentally breaking software development. We can't do that. We got to figure out a better way. And there is one. So I looked at modern industrial factories, right? Factories that build stuff, you know, real world things. And they're littered with sensors these days. There's sensors for, there's cameras, there's moisture detectors, they have vibration detectors, they've got cameras everywhere, all kinds of sensors everywhere throughout their factory. And the reason that they do that is so that they can monitor every step of the process, compare it against their model, and make instant corrections to the process. So if a bearing starts to get burned out, it'll create a new vibration in that part of the factory, and they'll detect it instantly, right? So we've got all these sensors. They all have all these incredible adapters to bring all that data together. You got to get it in a common form. So they've got adapters. So we got sensors and adapters. They actually do bring all this stuff together into what's called a programmable logic controller. All this data comes together. They make a big database full of all this data. They run smart analytics. That's where the model gets compared to the actual results from the sensors. And then all that data turns into beautiful dashboards and alerts that tell people when stuff is going wrong, right? So what they've done is they've completed this real-time feedback loop. Almost instantly when something goes wrong, they get notified, they can fix it right away. They don't go way off track before something gets done. So that's the pattern that I think we can emulate in AppSec. Sensors, adapters, analytics, and dashboards. So let's look at how that might work. And I've heard at the conference, I've heard a lot of people talking about, any individual tool is not very good, but when you put a bunch of these bad tools together, you can get better results. And I'm going to say I'm not convinced. I've tried this in a number of organizations, but running bad tools that have really high signal noise ratio, that are spotty in their coverage, that are difficult to use, and that require experts, running multiple of them has significant problems. First of all, it's just harder, right? Every one of those new tools that you try to run, you've got to onboard the application, you've got to run the actual test, you got to get the results out of it, you got to tailor the tool, you got to merge the results, and then you got to do triage on the results. It's time consuming. And second, what's really disturbing is you're going to lose the things. The idea is that you then focus on the vulnerabilities that multiple tools find, right? Because you think they're higher confidence. But what you'll lose is the things that those tools do really well, uniquely well, right? If you've got a tool that does a couple of things really, really well, you're going to lose those because they're not going to be corroborated by anything else. So that's a real problem. I believe what we need is much better sensors, simple, accurate sensors that do a great job. And so to that end, I'm incredibly excited to announce a new free application security sensor, and it's probably unlike anything you've seen before. So this is, let me just get on my right slide. This is Contrast for Eclipse, and some of you may have seen a demo out there. And I just wanted to be absolutely clear. I did verify with the OWASP board that this is absolutely okay to talk about at an OWASP conference. This is a 100% free tool. So I just wanted to make sure everybody knows that, doesn't freak out. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this tool up here. So I have a little trouble with my screen here. Here we go. All right, so this is Contrast for Eclipse. It's incredibly easy to install. You just go to the Eclipse Marketplace, download it just like any other Eclipse plugin. And what it does is it automatically analyzes your application as you use it. So when you start up Contrast, it's going to look like this. Let me clear out these files. So we're just starting from scratch here. And in order to use it, we've added something to the start menu here. So I've got a server started already, but you just right-click on this and you say, start with Contrast instead of the normal start. Okay, so developers can just run this very similar to the way they normally work. And what Contrast does is, as the application starts, Contrast instruments the app with a bunch of passive sensors. Those sensors gather data directly from inside the application. These sensors have access to a ton of information not just the code like a static tool, although we can access the code, and not just the HTTP request like a dynamic tool. We have access to all of that and access to information like the runtime data flow, all the libraries and frameworks that are in the application. We have access to the configuration files, even all the backend connections. We see everything that's going on inside the application, and we can make great security findings with all that data. So what I'm going to show you here is just a simple web application. I've started this up, and I've got contrast enabled. So I've got contrast over here, and we'll just clear out any findings because it keeps finding stuff because the application's in use. And I'm just going to go to the main page of contrast. And that's cute. The screen resolution is kind of messing this up. So I'm going to go to main.jsp here. I mean, home.jsp. And I'm just, so here's the sort of the main app. Contrast has already started analyzing this application. And I think if I go to register, there's a whole menu here. You know what, I'm just going to go over to this and just register. This is the same application running. It's just an external browser as opposed to an internal browser. So I'm just going to register, put in my name, Jeff Williams. I might have mistyped that. Whatever. Chicago. And some credit card number. And submit that. Contrast analyzes that request in real time, and the results show up immediately in the Contrast for Eclipse plugin here. So then, let me make this full screen so you can see it. What we're seeing here is a trace for a cross-site scripting problem discovered in this page. And I'm going to slide this over so we can see the whole trace. What we see is the exact line of code where this data came into the application, the request.get parameter. We can see some other parameters that come into the application. We can see all the transitions as data is built and then finally sent out to the web page. Sort of the canonical example of a cross-site scripting flaw, right? You guys have probably all seen examples like this. Since we have all this, we're right in Eclipse. You can click on the line of code and go directly to the exact line of code. So notice this is in the person class here. And we trace it through profile.jsp where this data gets split and eventually down to the line of code where this gets written out to the HTTP response. So really detailed information. We actually have all the stack traces for this event. So you can see, here's the actual runtime data from the container. If you're a developer and you really want to track this down. And we have the full HTTP request. This is a real differentiator because static tools only give you lines of code, but they don't give you a test case. So you can never really know if it's real. Dynamic tools only give you HTTP information. They don't give you the line of code, so that's hard to track down. Contrast is running inside the app, so we have access to both of those pieces of information. So we can give you a really full-featured finding that will help you find and remediate this thing. So we've got a bunch of details here. You can see there's guidance on how to fix it. A risk summary. But this is a free plugin. Every Java developer in the world, as far as I'm concerned, should be checking their code with this before they check it in. Because we've lowered the burden of doing application security checks to almost zero on developers. They can do this over and over as they run. This thing is actually real time, and let me give you a demonstration of that. This is Selenium IDE. This is a Firefox plugin. And Selenium is an easy way to build test cases and scripts that exercise a website. So all I did is I hit record here, and I just clicked through the links and menus in this ticket book app, and then save that. And now I can just replay that whenever I want. So what this does is it actually just exercises the application. You can see contrast is running at wire speed here, and the vulnerabilities are just pouring in to the Eclipse plugin in real time. Okay? So we can look at a couple of these. Here's a command injection. Let's look at the evidence because that will show you exactly where it happens. This is command.jsp has a line where it brings in data and then it writes it out. It calls it in the runtime.exec. We can see all kinds of vulnerabilities this way. Down at the bottom, you can see these are library vulnerabilities. So we're actually analyzing all the libraries and components and frameworks that are part of this application and giving you data on whether they have known vulnerabilities. This is sort of OWASP top 10 A9. give you coverage over that, so you know, developers can instantly say, oh, I don't want that vulnerability. I better update my library to the latest version. And the analysis that Contrast is doing here is actually pretty sophisticated. It's covering the entire application, not just the source code, but the entire application, all the libraries, all the frameworks, even down to the Java runtime. We track the data wherever it goes. And what that does is that dramatically reduces the number of false alarms that the traditional tools get. When we track a string through the application, we're actually tracking that particular string wherever it goes. So we don't have to guess. We don't lose track strings when they go into collections or when they move around and get sliced and diced through an application. So this technique that we're using here is something Gartner calls IAST, or Interactive Application Security Testing. And it's the idea of using instrumentation to find vulnerabilities like this and give sort of real-time continuous feedback to folks. So I encourage you to check out this Contrast for Eclipse plugin. Give it to your developers. See how they like it. This is a brand new tool on the market. It's a new technique, and we're absolutely looking for all the feedback we can get on, does this help? Does this work? Does giving developers a really great sensor for application security problems, does that allow them to check in secure code? We're hoping that it does. Okay. So let me go back to the presentation here. So that was great, right? That's a great developer tool, but it's not a whole application security program, and I would never try to claim that. Putting in a single sensor in a sort of one part of a development organization, the IDE, isn't going to solve application security for everything. I really think you need to instrument that whole software development factory, right? Not just the IDE, but all the different systems and processes that code goes through before it gets to live. It's trying to get that culture of instrumentation to catch fire within your organization and get people to rely on it. So the good news is this is probably already happening within your organization. So lots of teams are now, who's doing some variant of Agile or DevOps software development, right? So that's like at least half the room. These processes rely on instrumentation to produce high quality code. And when I first heard about XP and Agile and DevOps, I was a little skeptical, right? I was like, that's going to be a disaster for security. But it turns out I was 100% wrong, and I've come 180 degrees on this. So with traditional sort of waterfall models with rare release cycles, your project can get way off track from what it's trying to build before there's sort of a correction back to the model. And that introduces a lot of risk. The farther you get away from your model before you check and get back on track, the worse off you are. With Agile and DevOps, those cycles are much shorter, so you've got many more opportunities to sort of correct and stay on track, which results in a lot less risk. So I was talking to Nick Galbraith from Twitter a few weeks ago, actually, and we had a great conversation about this process and why DevOps is good for security, and he said something interesting. He said, these continuous practices force software development shops to establish the infrastructure to measure software automatically, right? They build the infrastructure to do automated model testing for whatever they, whatever they define as quality. They test it automatically, and they've got the infrastructure to do it. So they run Jenkins, and they run all their unit tests at continuous integration time. Every time you check in code, all the tests run. They've automated this. This is awesome for security because they've provided the infrastructure for organizations to do great application security testing. But it's just an opportunity. It's not a guarantee. DevOps is not going to produce secure code just by itself. But it gives us an opportunity to instrument the software process so that it will produce secure code. And I like Dan Kaminsky's quote here too. He said, to survive this, meaning he's a little more apocalyptic about the way software development is going. Just to survive this, we have to monitor, we have to report, and we have to adapt in real time to our mistakes. And that's exactly what I'm talking about here, is how do we adapt to our mistakes faster? So my colleagues at AppSec Security have spent the last year working with clients, trying to help them build continuous AppSec programs. Basically, what they did is they started out with software development trends like DevOps and Agile and mixed in a whole bunch of application security practices. And they got these practices from all over the place. Historical stuff like the Orange Book and the Common Criteria, the maturity models from the 90s. They looked at CNA processes. They looked at all different, you know, OWASP stuff. They looked at all different approaches to application security, and they threw away everything that doesn't directly contribute to security. Right, that's a key. It's got to, you know, be related to getting close to that model. Anything that doesn't scale, right? Anything that's not real time, so you know, sort of instant feedback. Anything that's irritating, and I don't know how to describe that better, but anything that's going to irritate developers is going to alienate everybody and wreck it. And anything that's tied to a particular phase of the life cycle. And you know, so for example, some things that a lot of organizations try to do or think they should be doing, like security requirements and security architecture diagrams, and to some extent threat modeling diagrams, you know, these things don't meet a lot of these criterias, right? And you know, frankly, I can't think of a lot of projects where I've gone to where all the developers are intimately familiar with the security requirements and the architecture diagram. Those practices just really aren't working at DevOps speed and portfolio scale. So we took what's left and we refactored it into a model we call continuous application security. And we put together this handbook. It describes the 8 practices of continuous application security. It's 8 activities that are designed to augment existing software processes, not replace, not change, not break, but augment existing software processes so that they can do continuous application security. Relies heavily on automated sensors. It's performed continuously throughout the development organization, so it's not something that you do at a particular phase. It focuses on whether the security's been achieved. Really, that's the sole focus of continuous. And what we've tried to do is make sure that experts are not involved in the critical software development path anywhere. And I'll talk a little bit more about that as we go forward. So these are the 8 activities in continuous AppSec. And today, we've got time. We're only going to focus on the middle 3 because we just don't have time to talk about everything. So these 3 core activities, their whole purpose in life is to create a tight feedback loop. Remember we talked about the 9450? You got a model. You got sensors to measure against that, and then you've got visibility dashboards to present that data. That's what we're trying to create with these 3 core practices. And so in most organizations, those 3 core practices are probably enough to get all the rest of this done. They'll sort of happen naturally. Once you infect an organization with continuous metrics, the rest of these things will probably happen. But let's dig into these core things. So the first practice is instrument everything. And so you remember the software factory? I want to see instrumentation across the whole development organization. It's actually pretty easy to make these sensors. You can use existing tools and wrap them so that they run continuously at various phases, you know, various places and phases within the software development organization. So for example, you can use a tool like ZAP, OWASP ZAP, which is a great tool. It's most people use it as sort of a pen test tool, a proxy, but it can run passively. It can sit as a proxy on the network and just passively detect vulnerabilities. So why not deploy that into your test region, get your testers to test the application through ZAP, and get great data about how your application actually works. You want to monitor the HTTP headers? Great, ZAP can watch those. You can build custom tests into ZAP if you want to monitor for particular things, like your application is supposed to generate a CSRF token that looks like something. ZAP can verify that for you. There's a language built into ZAP called Zest, which allows you to specify those things and run them continuously. And that's once you set that up, that's basically free, right? That's just going to run continuously. You didn't have to do any extra work. You didn't have to pen test. You didn't have to run any complex tools. You get all that data for free. So what you're doing is then you've got a whole bunch of complex tests that you need to run. You can knock off a few of those and turn them into sensors that run continuously. And slowly, we're going to shift from these complex manual processes to automated non-expert processes over time. Then at the end, there's probably going to be some things left that you need experts for to test because they're just that complicated. I think you can probably automate almost anything if you work hard enough at it. But you know, there's probably going to be some things left that you want experts for. That's great. But you've automated everything that you really can. So to make a sensor, what you really have to do is take that tool, wrap it in something that will run it continuously, like Puppet is a great choice. It can push out sensors and get them to run on a schedule. You also have to extract the data from those tools and turn it into some common form that, you remember those adapters that we talked about in the industrial factories? You got to convert that data into something you can use. So you take all the data and bring it together in some kind of data warehouse or data hub where you can actually analyze it and use it then to create the great dashboards. So, what just happened? I think I went twice. I like what Alex Demos, he's the CISO at Yahoo, said about this. He's like, everybody's trying to sell me pizza boxes with some fancy technology in it. And what I really want is I want software sensors with centralized intelligence. That's what I'm talking about, right? Software sensors that monitor applications as they're being developed and in production that generate this data and bring it together so we can make smart decisions. And I like what it says right on the 9450 here. It says the ball don't lie. That's what I'm talking about with these sensors, right? This is data that nobody can argue with, right? It's not a judgment call. It's just data that's coming in and creating a great dashboard that everyone can rely on. Gene Kim, who's the author of The Phoenix Project, which if you haven't read it, you really ought to read it because you'll recognize a lot of your own organization in the book. And he's got a lot of great lessons about how to think about the changes that are happening to the way software is built. But he had a great quote. He said, if you have code that's important enough to deploy, then it's important enough to instrument. And I absolutely believe that. I think the future of software is that everything's going to be instrumented. And I wanted to talk about a company called New Relic. Is anybody familiar with New Relic? Okay, so what New Relic does is they have a sensor that monitors performance of applications. You just drop it in your application, and when you run your application the normal way, it produces great data around performance. It times everything, back-end queries, request times, everything, and gives you a great dashboard. You don't have to do any extra work to get this, but what they did is they changed something that was an expert-based field, like AppSec. They changed performance engineering, which was like expert-based, into something that everyone can do for themselves. And that's what sensors can do for application security as well. And really, that's the only way we're going to scale it, because we've got way too much code and way too few of you guys to do this job. So this really isn't for just the unicorns, the Googles and the Etsys and the Twitters and the giant monsters. Anyone can do this for themselves. So the second practice is make security visible. We talked about sensors. Now we've got to make that data visible, right? So we need some analytics and some dashboards. So all those sensors, we're going to pull it together into some data warehouse. We're going to create some great dashboards. And I've worked on this with some organizations. So the folks at Aspect have worked with a financial organization that, when we started, they were basically doing triannual manual reviews on applications. Triannual reviews. And so their data was really spotty and really out of date. And what we were able to do is integrate some of these sensors into their software build process and gather some great data to give them instant feedback that's always up to date on these applications. And it's absolutely working and helping. The money that they would have spent on penetration testing is now being spent on creating sensors and automating. So it's been transformational for them in a very short amount of time. So they're on a great path. I wanted to show you a couple dashboards that I'm familiar with. At Yelp, this is a cool dashboard. If you're familiar with content security policy, the XSS prevention that's built into certain browsers, there's a way for CSP to give the application owner feedback directly from the browser. So Yelp is receiving thousands of reports a minute from CSP that's coming back in, and there's a ton of useful data. It's essentially a sensor that they've deployed, and it's telling them what's going on in their, you know, their huge array of applications out there. They've got a nice blog about it. The URL is there. But this is the kind of dashboard that developers can really use in real time and see what's going on. So another slide. This is Etsy's dashboards. And what they've done is they've, you know, this is Zane Lackey's quote. He says, you should surface security info for everyone, not just the application security team. And he's adamant that by making this data visible, it changes everything. The whole tone of security in their organization is different. Security guys and application people aren't confrontational. They work together. They go to this dashboard and they look and they see problems and they say, what are we going to do about that? And they think about it and they solve problems rather than, you know, sort of arguing and trying to call each other out and, you know, sort of self-aggrandizing themselves. So, you know, I really think that making these dashboards is an incredibly important piece. And again, anybody can do this. This is one that we threw together for the talk that I gave last year. This is nice. We run some simple open source tools, pull the data together, and you know, this gives you nice letter grade scores across a lot of different categories of security. So I definitely encourage you to build a network. For this, we used Puppet. So Puppet pushes out the sensors to the various app servers and schedules them for running. When they run, the data gets collected and it gets pushed back to what I'll call an application security data warehouse, where the analytics happen. First, all that data has to be, we call it digested. The data has to come in, and it comes in various formats, right? Some tools produce text, some produce XML, some produce HTML, all kinds of weird stuff. But what you want to do is sort of standardize that. So all the data is coming in a standard format, and then you can pull it together and make some really nice dashboards. Now, that's all great, but I want you to be smart about what sensors you put out there, right? You can't just grab a collection of tools. I said this earlier. You can't just take a collection of tools and just run them and think that you've covered everything, right? I want you to take control of security. And what that means is that you establish a model. I call it an expected security model. What that means is you've defined what you expect from your applications. Just like the 9450 has a model of what my game is supposed to look like, we need to have a model of what application security is supposed to look like. And it's not that complicated. For any one of the areas that you believe you want in your security program, like, you know, start with the business needs, push down to security strategies, and then translate those into specific expected requirements. Like, I would expect in my organization that all the encryption is done with AES. That's a simple statement. But I bet your organization has that policy in some manual somewhere, and I'd be willing to bet $1 zillion that you're using all kinds of different encryption algorithms when you actually get into the code and look at apps. We see this all the time, is that, you know, the standards don't match what's in the actual applications. So this process of sort of taking control of security is really important. You want to evolve your model. Now, a lot of people would say, well, we should start with the model. We should get a really detailed rundown of every single nitinoid security thing that we're going to do, because then we'll know what to build sensors for, and it's all very logical. Unfortunately, it doesn't really work. Nobody will pay for that paper exercise to build the model and build this, you know, abstract stuff, because they've seen it too many times before. So what you need to do is start with sensors. Start with great sensors for things that you know are important to your organization. Then once you get some real data, then the holes in your security story will be obvious. The gaps in that data will be obvious. Like, oh, I see you're checking for AES, but you're not checking for CBC and ECB. So we had to extend that check a little bit. Things like that. So this model evolves over time. And the way I like to think about this is, if you imagine, you know, sort of most organizations, if you look at the sort of the yellow circle, their expected model is really spotty, right? Your expected model is probably tied up in some documents that are stored in some content repository somewhere. Maybe it's in the tools that you use. Maybe it's in your pen tester's head a little bit. But there's no sort of one place where you can go to see the whole model. And then on the other side, the things that you're actually measuring aren't very clear either, right? So you hire a pen tester and they test some stuff, and they probably didn't check your expected model because there wasn't like one document. And so you get all this mishmash. What you end up with at the end is you really don't know whether you're secure. you've got some requirements and you've got some stuff that you tested, but it doesn't match up very well, and so you just have to decide, like, well, I guess we'll go live. I don't think that's a great way to do security. So I'm trying to get, you know, CAS is all about getting out of that. So if you look at those three core activities, they're designed to get that feedback loop started. Sensors, dashboard, get visibility, and then model to make sure that you've got the right stuff. And if you focus on that, all the other things sort of start to happen. I will go through the other five really quickly. The first one is, you know, you have to know your enemy. So you should be constantly monitoring the threat. And you can do that through OWASP or other organizations, but you need to stay on top of who might be attacking you so that you can update your model with that information. You need to implement strong defenses. And you could do application security without a set of common strong defenses, but I wouldn't try it. Application security is pretty complicated already, and by standardizing your defenses, by establishing your own enterprise security API, you can simplify both your model and the implementation of that model. You got to make it simpler, otherwise this stuff is just too intractable. So, you know, I've talked a lot about that standardization of controls, and it's really, really important. You should hack yourself, and I think it's important to constantly be looking for the gaps and flaws in both your story, your expected security model, and new and novel flaws in your implementations, right? So there's always going to be a role for security researchers who are doing great stuff. But again, I want them to focus on the things that you can't put sensors on or you don't know to put sensors on yet, right? The people in this room should not be testing for XSS and SQL injection and the simple stuff. We need to automate those things. And I was in a panel yesterday, and one of the panelists said that application security folks need to be coaches and toolsmiths, not directly involved in the critical path. So we need to make that conversion. One thing you can do right away is you convert your penetration testing practice into creation of sensors. So if a pen tester finds something, don't let them give you a PDF write-up of the flaw. Make them create a sensor to test for it for then on, right? Give me a script that I can run on all my code that will test this forever, right? That way, over time, you'll shift over to all sensors and you'll be just testing the really novel, really weird stuff where security researchers are necessary. That's what Mozilla has done, by the way. When they take bug reports, they expect them to come in Zest, that ZAP scripting language I mentioned, right? That way they're reproducible and they can run them as regression tests forever. This practice is about expecting failure and really, you know, incident detection, incident response is really important. You need to do it continuously. It's really part of your defense strategy. And so that's part of continuous AppSec. And then the last thing is I think that you can do things to promote security culture. Training and e-learning, I think, are some of the most effective security practices that you can have in place. But there's other things like executive memos and promote internal marketing and promotion that you can do. If you did all the other stuff, I don't think you'd need to do very much of this. But frankly, I think it's a great practice to make security culture really take hold fast. And that's it. Those are the eight practices. You really don't have to chase vulnerabilities all day. You can be more of a coach and more of a toolsmith. It really is a new world. I believe that all the data that we need is sitting out there in our development organizations, in the code, in the tools, in the practices. All we got to do is gather it up with great sensors that can find it. And today, I think we've given you a very powerful sensor. The contrast for Eclipse sensor, I think, is really powerful. We want to try to get it to every Java developer on the planet, because why not? And I could use your help. I want to try to spread the word on continuous application security. I think it's really important. I think it can change the way people do AppSec. And so if you're interested in helping me, please contact me. My contact information is on the next slide. You can reach me there or at Twitter at Planet Level. The reason I'm here, by the way, is I want to meet you guys. I want to meet everybody here. So please come up and find me and talk to me. I really get a lot out of that. So stop by our booth, pick up copy of the handbook. I got some up here. And don't forget to download the Eclipse plugin and give it a spin. It's a lot of fun. I really like it. So thanks for coming out. I'd love to take any questions. Yeah.
How about contrast?
We're going to see how this goes. I mean, the Eclipse is by far the biggest IDE, but no question, there is a way to sort of already use it with IntelliJ, and we can talk about that. But you know, we'll do the integration if people really like this.
How about contrast for Visual Studio?
Same thing, man. We can't do everything. So this is an experiment. We don't know if people will like this, if developers are really going to like it. So you know, let's try it. Let's see if this changes things. Yeah.
So does the tool actually inject code automatically for developers? Is that
yeah.
Instrumented?
Yeah.
So.
They don't have to do anything to their code, and you know, I'll switch over and put the tool back since people seem to like talking about tools. Yeah, so we're just, you know, sort of constantly monitoring the code. So as the bytecode loads, it actually instruments the code, so it adds passive sensors to the actual code. So the developers use their normal process to develop, their normal testing process. They don't change how they work at all, just like 9450. You just play normally, and it gives you great dashboards on how you're doing. That's what contrast does. Yes? Say again? Right now, so the underlying technology does work on client Java applications, but the way the Eclipse plugin is set up, it's designed to work with servers. But if that's something that you want really bad, let me know and we'll add a run as application with contrast. Yeah? Then contrast can't see it. So you should, you know, if you're interested in getting really good coverage, you should use a coverage tool like ECLMR or something like that to measure the coverage over the code. I will say that both dynamic tools and static tools get terrible coverage over the code base. There's a number of reasons for that. Static tools don't look at the libraries. So it's like, you know, a huge chunk of the code. Dynamic tools can only see what they see. Contrast, actually, just by using the application normally, contrast covers a good percentage of the code. In our experiments, we found that code coverage is much better than you'd get from traditional tools. But it's not perfect. I mean, we're not saying we cover every line. You got to write some test cases to exercise your code. Any other questions? Yeah. No. We should talk later about that. But instrumenting JavaScript code is possible, and we're, you know, exploring that. Yeah. You have to use the code. Now, normally, when a developer's working, they're normally writing some code and running it in the browser. So they're going to exercise the piece that they're working on really well. That's actually really important because they probably don't care about the other, you know, million lines of code that are out there. They really only care about the piece that they're working on right now. And so contrast will show them the vulnerabilities and the chunk that they're working on. So it, in a way, it closes that feedback loop in a really nice way. The static analysis tools, you get a 700-page PDF report, and somebody has to go through and go, well, oh, this one is Joe's and that one's Mary's, and you know, it breaks the feedback loop. Contrast has that right there feedback loop. By the way, we work on huge applications, you know, up to 20 million lines of code, no problem.
How is this different than
Finebugs? Finebugs is a static analysis tool. It doesn't do instrumentation or runtime. It's a different technique for trying to find flaws. Yeah, so I'm getting kicked out, so I'm happy to take any other questions. I'll be at the outside the door at the contrast booth.